कुछ। हेलो
हेलो
हेलो हेलो हेलो हेलो हेलो हेलो गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन। गुड इवनिंग टू डॉक्टर अब्बास सिंह, डॉक्टर कुमार गौरव कुमार, दीपेंद्र जयसुदा। Thank you everyone for joining us today for the live anatomy class. Welcome Dr. Satya, Prithvi Raj, Arvind Kumar. Today evening's live anatomy class is on pterygopalatine fossa and infratemporal fossa. I think it is one of the very important topics, especially for any person who wants to do rhinology and anterior skull base surgery. Coming to the topic per se, pterygopalatine fossa is a small, clinically inaccessible fat-filled space located in the deep of the face that serves as a major neurovascular crossroad between the oral cavity, nasal cavity, nasopharynx, orbit, masticator space and middle cranial fossa. I will deal with this topic on the following headlines, that is boundaries, contents and surgical importance. The inherent complex location and connections potentially of this pterygopalatine fossa acts as a natural conduit for the spread of many inflammatory and neoplastic disease. Pterygopalatine fossa is a small bony space between the posterior surface of the maxilla and pterygoid porous of the sphenoid bone. Basically, it is a small inverted space where it is bounded anteriorly by posterior or the infratemporal fossa, infratemporal surface of the maxilla, mainly the superior medial surface of the posterior surface of the maxilla. Medially, it is bounded by the perpendicular plate of the palatine bone. Palatine bone has two processes, that is an orbital process and the sphenoid process, which makes the sphenopalatine foramen. Posteriorly, the boundary of the pterygopalatine fossa is body of the sphenoid and pterygoid process of the sphenoid bone. Laterally, the pterygopalatine fossa communicates with the infratemporal fossa through pterygomaxillary fissure. And superiorly, the pterygopalatine fossa is in relationship with apex of the orbit and is in communication with the orbit through infraorbital fissure. It's an inverted apex region, that is, the vertex is small in space compared to the base. The height of a pterygopalatine fossa is around 2 centimeters. So the vertex is made up of by almost joining of the posterior surface, that is a pterygoid process of the sphenoid and the posterior surface of the maxilla. But there is a bone, that is a pyramidal process of the palatine bone, also contributes to the boundary of pterygopalatine fossa inferiorly. Contents of the pterygopalatine fossa are maxillary nerve, third part of maxillary artery, pterygopalatine ganglion, nerve of pterygoid canal. Coming to each one of them, first we will deal with the communications. There are 7 main communications of the pterygopalatine fossa with the various cavity, mainly nasal cavity, oral cavity, pharyngeal cavity, intracranial cavity, and so forth. It communicates with the infratemporal fossa through the pterygomaxillary fissure, that is laterally. Superiorly or anteromedially, the pterygopalatine fossa communicates with the orbit through infraorbital fissure. Medially, the pterygopalatine fossa communicates with the nasal cavity through the sphenopalatine foramen. Posteriorly, it has mainly 3 communication pathways, that is, one with the middle cranial fossa, that is through the foramen rotundum, another pterygoid canal, which communicates the pterygopalatine fossa with foramen lacerum, and the one more is pharyngeal canal, which communicates it with the nasopharynx. Inferiorly, it communicates through the greater palatine canal, which again divides into lesser palatine foramen and greater palatine foramen, and communicates with the Hello? Hello. Okay, we are coming to the communications of the pterygopalatine fossa here. Pterygopalatine fossa communicates superiorly with the orbit through the infraorbital fissure, medially to the nasal cavity through spinopalatine foramen. Posteriorly, it has communication to the middle cranial fossa through foramen rotundum. Hello. Hello. Maxillary nerve originates from the Gasserian ganglion or trigeminal ganglion. The trigeminal nerve is made up of four nucleus, that is sensory, motor, mesencephalic nucleus, following which the maxillary nerve passes through the lateral wall of the cavernous sinus, passes through the foramen rotundum and reaches the posterior wall of the pterygopalatine fossa. In the pterygopalatine fossa, it mainly gives sensory branches to the pterygopalatine ganglion, that is ganglionic branches it gives. In the pterygopalatine fossa, it gives another two branches, that is one superiorly which enters the infraorbital fissure, which is called zygomatic nerve, and another is posterior superior alveolar branch, following which the nerve continues in the infraorbital canal as infraorbital nerve, which reaches the infraorbital foramen and gives terminal branches to the face. Here again we come to see the different branches of the maxillary nerve. Passing through the foramen rotundum, reaching the pterygopalatine ganglia, giving the sensory branches, which is mainly for pain and temperature, giving a superior zygomatic branch, which goes to the infraorbital fissure, and which continues as infraorbital nerve in the infraorbital canal, reaches the face and gives terminal branches to the face, that is nasal branch, palpebral branch and labial branch. While passing through the infraorbital canal, it gives two more branches, that is middle superior alveolar nerve and anterior superior alveolar nerve. Why it is, since the placement of the branches is such that it is posterior, middle and anterior. The posterior superior alveolar nerve passes through the posterior wall of the maxilla and reaches the third molar and supplies the region of the third molar. Middle superior alveolar nerve supplies the premolars and anterior superior alveolar supplies the canine and the incisors. The rest of the branch is from the pterygopalatine ganglion branch that we will come later. Coming to the branches of the maxillary nerve in a nutshell, that is while passing from the middle cranial fossa to the foramen rotundum, it gives its first branch, that is a meningeal branch, which supplies the dura, because dura is the only pain sensitive structure. In pterygopalatine fossa, zygomatic branch, ganglionic branch, posterior superior alveolar nerve branch. Zygomatic branch enters the orbit, infraorbital fissure, and terminally divides into zygomatic facial and zygomatic temporal, where it receives the secretomotor fibers and combines with the lacrimal nerve of the ophthalmic division of the trigeminal nerve. The ganglionic branch supplies the sensory supply to the pterygopalatine ganglia, mainly the pain and temperature. Posterior superior alveolar nerve enters the posterior surface of the maxilla and supplies the molar. Anterior superior alveolar nerve is given by the main trunk of the infraorbital nerve. Entering the orbit gives branches to premolars, canine and incisors. The terminal branches of the infraorbital nerve, which comes out through the infraorbital foramen, is palpebral, nasal, labial, branches to lower eyelid, anterior nasal aperture and anterior cheek. Coming to pterygopalatine ganglion, which is also called spinopalatine ganglion, Meckel's ganglion or spinopalatine ganglion, is a parasympathetic ganglion found in the pterygopalatine fossa. As we all know, each parasympathetic ganglion has a preganglionic branch and a postganglionic branches. The parasympathetic supply is mainly from the superior salivatory and lacrimal nucleus, which is situated in the pons. Through the nervous intermedius branch of the facial nerve, it traverses through the middle ear, passes through the greatest superficial petrosal nerve and enters the foramen lacerum, where it again joins with the deep petrosal nerve, forms the vidian nerve, passes through the pterygoid canal as nerve of the pterygoid canal and reaches the pterygopalatine fossa, where it is relayed in the ganglion. The postganglionic fibers mainly supply the lacrimal gland, that is passing through the orbital branches, nasal and palatine glands. The sympathetic supply, that is a vasoconstrictor supply, that is mainly from the T1 and T2 segments of the spinal cord, where it is mainly relayed in the superior cervical sympathetic ganglion, from which the postganglionic fibers forms a plexus around the internal carotid artery, from which the branch called deep petrosal nerve branches out at the level of the foramen lacerum, joins with the greater petrosal nerve in the pterygoid canal and passes through the pterygopalatine ganglion. The other branches of the pterygopalatine ganglion are sensory branches, mainly for pain and temperature. This is a diagram showing the pterygopalatine ganglion receiving its branches from the deep and deep petrosal and greater petrosal nerve. The branches of the pterygopalatine ganglion are orbital branches, which are secretomotor to lacrimal and ethmoidal air cells. Descending branches are greater palatine nerve, which mainly supplies the hard palate and posterior inferior lateral nasal branches, nasal wall. And lesser palatine nerve, which supplies the soft palate. The unique part with the lesser palatine nerve is it has the branch for taste also, which is supplied from the nucleus tractus solitarius, which gives taste sensation, supplies the taste sensation to soft palate and tonsil. Posteriorly, it gives pharyngeal branch, which supplies the pharyngeal mucosa around the eustachian and around the eustachian tube orifice. Medially, it gives posterior superior medial nasal branch, which again divides into medial and lateral branch. The medial branch descends along the septum down towards the hard palate and reaches the incisive foramen. And lateral branches mainly supplies the lateral nasal wall. The other medial branches are nasopalatine nerves, which supplies the roof of the mouth, and posterior superior lateral nasal branches. Coming to the one more content of the pterygopalatine fossa, that is nerve of pterygoid canal, that is Bidian canal. The nerve of the pterygoid canal is formed by the junction of greater petrosal nerve and deep ventrosal nerve within the pterygoid canal, containing the cartilaginous substance within which fills the foramen lacerum. It passes forwards through the pterygoid canal with its corresponding artery, that is artery of pterygoid canal. And it is also joined by a small ascending branch of splenoidal branch from the otic ganglion. Enters the pterygopalatine fossa at the posterior angle. This is a diagram showing the deep the nerve sympathetic plexus giving rise to the deep petrosal nerve around the internal carotid artery at the level of the foramen lacerum, and greater petrosal superficial petrosal nerve joining in the pterygoid canal to form the Bidian nerve, which enters the pterygopalatine fossa at the posterior angle. The importance of the Bidian canal. It is one of the most important structure to be identified in a CT scan while during doing an anterior skull base surgery. There are various type of Bidian canal. Type 1 is Bidian canal, which lies completely within the floor of the sphenoid sinus. Type 2 is a Bidian canal partially protrudes into the floor of the sphenoid sinus. Type 3 is which is completely embedded in the body of the sphenoid. This is a type 1 Bidian canal, which passes through the floor of the sphenoid sinus. Here in the type 2, which slightly protrudes into the floor of the sphenoid sinus, where in here it is completely in the body of the sphenoid. Coming to the next content of the pterygopalatine fossa, that is the maxillary artery. It is the main arterial supply of the infratemporal fossa. It is one of the largest terminal branches of the external carotid artery. The other terminal branch of the external carotid artery is superficial temporal artery. The maxillary artery arises from the just posterior to the neck of the mandible in the substance of the parotid gland and courses around somewhat obliquely through the fossa to end in the pterygomaxillary fissure. Through its course, it is usually lying laterally, that is superficial to the lateral pterygoid muscle, but it can be sometimes seen deep to the muscle, that is called the variation of the maxillary artery. This is initially the first part of the maxillary artery, second part of the maxillary artery, and this is the third part of the maxillary artery, which is present in the pterygopalatine fossa. Coming to the various the lateral pterygoid muscle actually divides the maxillary artery into three parts. That is first part, second part and the third part. First part is in front of the stylomandibular ligament along the lower border of the lateral pterygoid. Second part is deep to the lateral pterygoid or sometimes superficial. Third part is which enters the pterygopalatine fossa through the pterygomaxillary fissure. The branches of each part are deep auricular branch of the deep auricular, anterior tympanic, middle meningeal, accessory meningeal and inferior alveolar branch is given from the first part of the maxillary artery. This is a this part showing the first part of the maxillary artery. The following branches, that is deep auricular branch. Here from the external carotid artery there are two terminal branches, that is maxillary artery and superficial temporal artery, following which there are the branches of the first part of the maxillary artery. That is first branch is deep auricular branch, next is anterior tympanic branch, middle meningeal branch which traverses intracranially through the foramen spinosum, and accessory meningeal also traverses intracranially through foramen ovale. It gives a inferior branches, that is a branch to the myelohyoid artery and inferior alveolar artery. The second part of the maxillary artery gives muscular branches, buccal branch, deep temporal artery and artery to the pterygoid muscle. In the third part of the maxillary artery gives infraorbital artery which passes through the infraorbital fissure along with the infraorbital nerve. The posterior superior alveolar artery which passes along the nerve, spinopalatine artery, greater and lesser palatine artery along the greater and lesser palatine nerve traversing through the same foramen, pharyngeal artery which traverses through the pharyngeal canal, and artery to the pterygoid canal which traverses along the median nerve. Mainly coming to the third part of the maxillary artery which is present in the pterygopalatine fossa, which enters the fossa through pterygomaxillary fissure. Greater palatine and lesser palatine arteries through the greater palatine and lesser palatine canal supplies the heart and the soft palate. This posterior superior alveolar artery mainly supplies the upper alveolus containing the molars, premolars and maxillary sinus. Spinopalatine artery mainly enters the nose through the posterior part of the superior meatus through the spinopalatine foramen and supplies the surrounding area. Artery of pterygoid canal supplies the roof of the pharynx. Pharyngeal artery supplies the roof of the nasopharynx. Infraorbital artery passing continuation of the maxillary artery, the end part of the maxillary artery, traverses through the inferior orbital fissure along with the infraorbital nerve. And anterior superior alveolar, it also exits through the infraorbital foramen, again supplying the upper alveolus. This is a picture showing the nerves with its corresponding arteries passing through the foramens. Coming to the radiology, exactly in the axial cuts where it is showing the foramen rotundum, median canal and pterygopalatine fossa. This is a region of foramen rotundum, median canal, pterygopalatine fossa communicating with the infratemporal fossa. Now coming to the infratemporal fossa. The infratemporal fossa is a complex and irregularly shaped space located deep to the masseter muscle. It acts as a conduit for many neurovascular structures that travel between the cranial cavity and the other structures of the head. A precise knowledge of these structures and boundaries help to reduce our intraoperative complications or exact locations of the anatomical structures. Boundaries of infratemporal fossa are: anteriorly it is bounded by the posterior surface of the maxilla, posteriorly by the styloid process, carotid sheath, D
deep part of the parotid gland, medially by the lateral pterygoid plate, laterally by the ramus and coronoid process of the mandible. The roof is mainly formed by the greater wing of the sphenoid. This is the lateral pterygoid plate, which forms the medial boundary of the infratemporal fossa. The mandible forms the lateral boundary of the infratemporal fossa, anteriorly by the posterior surface of the maxilla, superiorly by the greater wing of the sphenoid. The contents of the infratemporal fossa are lateral and medial pterygoid muscles, infratemporal pad of fat, buccal lymph node, mandibular nerve, cauda tympani nerve, maxillary artery, pterygoid plexus of veins, otic ganglion, spinomandibular ligament. Coming to the muscles, there are four muscles of mastication, that is mainly temporalis muscle, masseter, medial and lateral pterygoid. Lateral pterygoid and medial pterygoid mainly forms the content of the infratemporal fossa. Lateral pterygoid muscle has two heads, that is upper and lower head. The upper head originates from the greater wing of the sphenoid and lower head from the lateral aspect of the lateral pterygoid plate. It passes backwards and gets inserted to the mandible. The main action of the lateral pterygoid muscle is protrusion of the jaw. Medial pterygoid muscle is a quadrangular or quadrilateral in shape. It also has two heads, a superficial head and a deep head. The origin of the superficial head is from the tuberosity of the maxilla and deep head from the medial surface of the lateral pterygoid plate. The fibers of the medial pterygoid plate, a pterygoid muscle, passes downwards and backwards to get inserted into the roughened surface of the angle of the mandible on the medial surface of the mandible near the angle it gets inserted. The main action of the medial pterygoid muscle is elevation of the mandible and assists the lateral and protrusive movements of the mandible. It also assists in the side-to-side movement of the mandible. Coming to the one more aspect of the infratemporal fossa, or the content, that is infratemporal pad of fat. Whenever we do a surgery where the posterior wall of the maxilla is removed, first we encounter the infratemporal pad of fat. It mainly lies between the temporalis muscle and the infratemporal surface of the maxilla. The importance of this fat is it helps especially in during a CT scan where it outlines the posterior antral spread of the tumor. And this temporal pad of fat also continues to the cheek, to the buccal space between the posterior wall of the maxilla and the zygoma. So any mass which is enlarging in the infratemporal fossa displaces this pad of fat anteriorly, which is seen as a swelling over the cheek, as encountered mainly in juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma. The one more content is buccal lymph node. Within this infratemporal pad of fat, there is called a buccal lymph node. This lymph node links the infratemporal lymphatics to the facial lymphatics, where the lymphatics from the infratemporal fossa and pterygopalatine fossa drains to the facial lymphatics. In the facial lymphatics, it mainly drains into submandibular group or deep cervical groups, that is mainly the upper deep cervical groups. The importance of this buccal lymph node is the enlargement or any infection in the infratemporal fossa, it can lead to the infection of this lymph node and into this contiguous space infections of the masseteric space or the buccal space. And it is very important that we resect the lymph node present in the infratemporal fossa, especially in a malignant tumor resection, because Leaving behind a pound of this lymph node might lead to a local recurrence later. Coming to the next content of the infratemporal fossa is the mandibular nerve, which is a V3, that is a third branch of the trigeminal nerve, trigeminal ganglion. Arises from the trigeminal ganglion in the middle cranial fossa. Immediately it receives a motor root from the motor nucleus of the trigeminal ganglion. It leaves the cranium through the foramen of Weyl directly into the infratemporal fossa. This is where the mandibular nerve is leaving the cranium and entering to the infratemporal fossa in the region of the foramen of Weyl. As soon as it descends down into the infratemporal fossa, it divides into the anterior and posterior division, each division giving certain branches. Also the trunk of the mandibular nerve will give certain branches. The branches arising from the trunk are the spinous nerve, which traverses in this foramen spinosum, medial pterygoid nerve. When the mandibular nerve divides into the anterior division and the posterior division, the branches of the anterior division are buccal nerve, mesenteric nerve, deep temporal nerve, lateral pterygoid nerve. The posterior branches of the mandibular nerve are auriculotemporal nerve, lingual nerve, and inferior alveolar nerve. The spinous nerve, which is a branch from the main trunk of the mandibular nerve, passes through the spinous foramen, enters the cranium. It's a sensory nerve. It mainly supplies the dura, which is the pain sensitive structure. The medial pterygoid nerve, which innervates the medial pterygoid muscle, tensor veli palatini muscle and tensor tympani muscle. The buccal nerve, mesenteric nerve, deep temporal nerves and lateral pterygoid nerve innervate the respective muscles. Buccal nerve is a sensory nerve and it innervates the inner surface of the cheek. Coming to the posterior branch of the mandibular nerve is auriculotemporal nerve. It mainly supplies sensory fibers to the auricle and the temporal region. It also provides articular fibers to temporomandibular joint. It is involved in the postsynaptic parasympathetic supplies the postsynaptic parasympathetic secretomotor fibers from the otic ganglion to the parotid gland. It is said that otic ganglion is functionally related to glossopharyngeal nerve, but topographically it is related to mandibular nerve through auriculotemporal nerve. Coming to inferior alveolar nerve, it enters the mandibular foramen and passes through the mandibular canal, forming the inferior dental plexus, which sends branches to the mandibular teeth on its sides. The terminal branch of the inferior alveolar nerve is the mental nerve, which passes through the mental foramen. Coming to the cauda tympani nerve, which is one more content of the infratemporal fossa. It is a branch of the facial nerve and it mainly carries taste fibers from the nucleus tractus solitarius to the anterior two-thirds of the tongue. It joins the lingual nerve in the infratemporal fossa. It carries secretomotor fibers for the submandibular and salivary gland. The secretomotor fibers are relayed in the submandibular ganglion. The lingual nerve has sensory supply to the anterior two-thirds of the tongue, the floor of the mouth and the lingual gingiva. Coming to the parasympathetic ganglion related topographically with the mandibular nerve, that is otic ganglion. is located in the infratemporal fossa,
just inferior to the foramen ovale. It contains mainly presynaptic parasympathetic fibers, that is preganglionic parasympathetic fibers from the glossopharyngeal nerve through the lesser petrosal nerve and synapse in the otic ganglion. The postganglionic parasympathetic fibers secretory to the parotid gland passes from the otic ganglion to this gland through the auriculotemporal nerve. Sympathetic root is mainly derived from the plexus around the middle meningeal artery, which contains the postganglionic fibers mainly from the superior cervical ganglion, which reaches the auriculotemporal nerve without relaying in otic ganglion. This is showing the parotid gland, auriculotemporal nerve giving the parasympathetic or secretomotor fibers to the parotid ganglion, where the caudate tympani preganglionic fibers is derived from the glossopharyngeal nerve, which is relayed in the otic ganglion, and post synaptic parasympathetic supply is through the auriculotemporal nerve to the parotid ganglion. The sympathetic is mainly postganglionic, which is supplied from the around the middle meningeal artery. It is postganglionic fibers from the superior cervical ganglion. Coming to the venous system in the infratemporal fossa and pterygopalatine fossa, that is pterygoid venous plexus. It has many tributaries. It is mainly has connections with the deep facial vein, superficial temporal vein. It is mainly through the maxillary vein, and it has various connections to the intracranial or cavernous sinus through the superior ophthalmic vein. The venous system in the head and neck is, since it's valveless, there is a high chance of the spread of any infection retrograde to the cavernous sinus. The tributaries of pterygoid venous plexus are spinopalatine, middle meningeal, deep temporal, pterygoid, mesenteric, buccinator, alveolar, and some palatine veins and infraorbital vein. The importance of the pterygoid venous plexus, that is, one is there is a chance of intraoperative bleeding when manipulating the structures in the region of the pterygopalatine fossa and infratemporal fossa. And its due communication with the cavernous sinus, it can any superficial facial infection or any infection from the dangerous space of the area may spread to the cavernous sinus, causing cavernous sinus thrombosis. Coming to spinomandibular ligament, a flat thin band which is attached superiorly to the spine of the spinoid bone and becoming broader as it descends down. It is fixed to the lingula of the mandibular foramen. It limits mainly the distension of the mandible in the inferior direction. The communications of the infratemporal fossa are: superiorly, it communicates with the middle cranial fossa by various neurovascular foramina like carotid canal, jugular foramen, foramen spinosum, foramen ovale, foramen lacerum. Medially, with the pterygopalatine fossa through the pterygomaxillary fissure, and with the orbit through the infraorbital fissure. Coming to the clinical significance of pterygopalatine fossa and infratemporal fossa. Referred otalgia is one of the most common symptoms you will encounter in the OPD. That is, mandibular nerve also innervates a portion of the ear, by that is the auriculotemporal nerve. So hence, any pain of the dental caries or dental tooth may be referred to the ear. Foramen ovale lesion, that is any paresthesia of the mandible teeth and the side of the face, or the paralysis of the muscles of the mastication should give us a clue there might be any lesion in the infratemporal fossa or the adjacent area near the foramen ovale. the superior palatine ganglion is also called hay fever ganglion.
In most allergic states, the congestion of the nasal gland, lacrimal gland and palatine gland results in continuous running nose, lacrimation, nasal obstruction, that is mainly due to the stimulation of the pterygopalatine ganglion. Hence it is called hay fever ganglion, because hay fever is one of the allergen. Next, coming to one of the most important clinical importance is one of the DDs for or the differential diagnosis for headache and facial pain is sphenopalatine neuralgia or Sludge's neuralgia. It's mainly in vascular in origin. Pain mainly seen in the forehead, eyebrows, over nasal bones. It sometimes is mistaken for the pain of sinusitis, usually because the same area is also involved in case of sinusitis. It comes in paroxysms around 3 to 4 episodes per day. Symptoms of rhinorrhea, lacrimation, injected conjunctiva, swollen nasal mucous membrane, facial flushing and photophobia are seen. Any medications with decongestants fail to relieve the symptoms of rhinorrhea or nasal obstruction. Touching the middle turbinate elicits the symptoms. The treatment is either sometimes it is seen that a sharp septal spur might be impinging on the middle turbine. The various treatment options have been tried before. That is, one is use of cocaine in the region of sphenopalatine ganglion abolishes the symptoms. And if there is a presence of any septal spur impinging on the middle turbinate, the treatment is submucosal resection. The next option in such cases are in case of pathological rhinitis is Vidian neurectomy. Indications, one of the clinical indications is severe intractable vasomotor rhinitis and crocodile tears. The clinical importance of Vidian canal and foramen rotundum. If you draw a line joining the foramen rotundum and Vidian canal, the pneumatization of the sphenoid bone lateral to the line joining the foramen rotundum and Vidian canal is called lateral recess of the sphenoid sinus. The one more clinical significance of the infratemporal fossa is infections of the infratemporal fossa. It might be spread through the causes of infratemporal infections are pericoronitis, dental abscess, spread of infection from the adjacent tissue spaces like buccal space, mesenteric space. The main symptoms with involves is trismus. It can again spread anteriorly to the buccal space, superiorly to the orbit, to the superior orbital fissure, cavernous sinus and intracranial cavity. So it is very important that we identify the infection of the infratemporal fossa earlier and manage appropriately. Coming to the nerve blocks, there are various nerve blocks which can be given due to do a procedure, maybe to do a dental extraction or to do nasal procedures under local anesthesia. Few local nerve blocks can be given, that is inferior alveolar nerve block, maxillary nerve block, mandibular nerve block. The inferior alveolar nerve block is given by inserting the needle lateral to the pterygomandibular raphe, that is about 6 to 8 mm above the occlusal table of the mandibular teeth, then sliding posteriorly along the medial aspect of the ramus. This area is approached from the contralateral premolar region, and the thumb of the other hand is used to retract the buccal mucosa pressing on the coronoid process, where you can reach the area of mandibular foramen. The tongue and the skin of the chin are anesthetized in this block because it is supplied by the lingual and the inferior alveolar nerve. This is pterygomandibular raphe. You palpate the coronoid notch and give in the region of mandibular foramen. Maxillary nerve block. By inserting the needle through the mandibular notch, that is in the gingivobuccal sulcus, that is opposite to the second molar, guiding it around 45 degrees superiorly and medially, palpating going along the pterygoid plate and until the pterygopalatine fossa is reached. This can be confirmed by the absence of any bony resistance. This can be given as it is one of the options for trigeminal neuralgia involving the maxillary division. This is how you reach the pterygopalatine fossa to anesthetize the maxillary nerve. Mandibular nerve block. By inserting the mandibular nerve block is mainly given by inserting the needle 4 mm deep through the mandibular notch, sliding posteriorly along the lateral surface of the pterygoid process around 2 to 3 centimeters it comes, where foramen ovale is reached. It's mainly useful in treating trigeminal neuralgia involving the mandibular division. Spinopalatine ganglion block is the indications given for a spinopalatine block. It can be given in during a local procedures of local nasal procedures. Otherwise, medically it's given for intractable medical resistant cluster headaches, migraine, and trigeminal autonomic cephalgias or intractable orofacial pain syndromes. The one more indication, one more clinical importance of the pterygopalatine fossa is maxillary artery or the spinopalatine artery ligation. It is mainly done in acute maxillo-epistaxis, recurrent epistaxis, in hereditary telangiectasia or syndromic syndromes like Osler-Rendau-Weber syndrome associated with epistaxis, and while operating nasopharyngeal angiofibroma. Coming to Frey's syndrome, is one of the clinical importance associated with auriculotemporal nerve. It has unilateral hyperhidrosis, flushing of the malar region, pinna on eating or drinking that stimulates the parotid gland to produce saliva. Occurs 2 to 13 months after surgery or trauma or infection of the parotid gland, caused by improper regeneration of the sympathetic and parasympathetic nerves subserving the parotid gland. There is a cross communication happening that results in this syndrome. The diagnostic test mainly done is minor iodine Schwartz test, where there is a change in the color. Treatment is symptomatic treatment, reassurance. Injection with botulinum A toxin can be given, or medical treatment can be tried with anticholinergics, antihydrotics, and surgical treatment is excision or muscle flap interposition. The pathologies, otherwise tumors pathologies involving the pterygopalatine fossa and infratemporal fossa, the primary tumors involving these areas: general isopharyngeal angiofibroma, schwannoma, neurofibroma, hemangiopericytoma, rhabdomyosarcoma, and chondrosarcoma. The secondary is mainly spread of tumors or lesions from the adjacent areas, like from nasopharynx, nasopharyngeal carcinoma, adenocarcinoma, and meningioma. There are various approaches to infratemporal fossa or pterygopalatine fossa. It can be divided into external approach and endoscopic approach. The external approach is again can be divided into anterior, anterolateral and lateral approaches. The anterior approaches are transoral, transantral, transpalatal approaches. Anterolateral approaches are transmaxillary, extended transmaxillary, maxillary sphinx and fascia. Inferior is transmandibular, transcervical approach. Lateral is transzygomatic, lateral infratemporal approaches. The other approaches are infratemporal approaches of fish type A, B, C and D, pre-orifacial translocation approach, pre-auricular infratemporal approach also can be done. Endoscopic approaches to pterygopalatine fossa and infratemporal fossa, depending upon the extent of the tumor present in the pterygopalatine fossa and infratemporal fossa, it can divided to just wide middle meatal antrostomy, prelacrimal approach, medial maxillectomy and modified Dengue's approach. The advantages of endoscopic approach: there is no facial scar or external incision present. It gives magnification, better visualization for the dissection of tissues. Due to since it is an endoscopic procedure, there is decreased morbidity in terms of function and scar. The surgical access to infratemporal fossa is divided into 5 zones depending upon the extent of the tumor present and the extent of exposure required. It is mainly divided to zone 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. Zone 1 is nasal cavity giving a unilateral nostril access to pterygopalatine fossa. 2 and 2 is medial to the infraorbital nerve. Zone 3 is lateral to infraorbital nerve. Zone 4 is anterior maxilla. And zone 5 is premaxillary tissue. Coming to the endoscopic approaches, wide middle meatal antrostomy and exposure. This picture shows a septum. This is a posterior wall of the maxillary sinus. It's a uninostril exposure. Giving exposure of the tumor, this is the lamina papyracea, and the exposure adequate, it gives both the lateral and the medial control over the tumor. Exposure in the, especially in endoscopic medial maxillectomy, the initial step in endoscopic medial maxillectomy is resection of the inferior turbinate, and the you do a wide middle meatal antrostomy and remove the medial wall of the maxilla in flush with the floor. It gives direct approach to the posterior wall of the maxilla, mainly tumor where the tumor is just extending to the infratemporal fossa, mainly involving the pterygopalatine fossa. Giving a approach to the posterior wall of the maxillary sinus, its identification after the removal of the periosteum and the bone of the posterior wall of the maxilla, the identification of spinopalatine artery and descending palatine artery. Here with careful dissection, descending palatine artery was identified and clipped. Removal of the tumor from the pterygopalatine fossa and pterygoid wedge is exposed in this area. A slight residual tumor is seen in this area. Drilling of the pterygoid wedge to remove the tumor. This is the vidal canal. This is a ligated SPA. This is the sphenoid sinus. This is a video showing a lady presenting with 57-year-old lady presenting with SOM, that is serous otitis media, was diagnosed as V3 schwannoma, suspected schwannoma, where inferior turbinate resection done and exposure to the modified Denker approach is given, where the anterior wall of the maxilla is removed to expose the posterior wall of the maxilla. This is lacrimal gland, where lacrimal gland is carefully transected, which would not give any post-operative epiphora. The trans crosscut axis is achieved here for binostral technique. Here the periosteum of the maxillary sinus is removed. Mucosa over the maxillary sinus is removed. The posterior wall of the maxillary sinus is exposed and which is drilled out. And the spinopalatine artery and descending palatine artery is identified and ligated. The wall is removed. Identification of the infratemporal pad of fat and internal maxillary artery is done. The internal maxillary artery is hooped around and it is ligated using LIGA clip. Following which the tissue is dissected out for the tumor exposure. In this case, due to the adequate exposure, we have got both the medial and lateral control over the tumor. Now the tumor is completely exposed. Pterygoid wedge is drilled out. Tumor is removed in segmental resection fashion after internal debulking. Segmental resection of the tumor is carried out. It shows the complete removal of the tumor. Hemostasis is achieved. The area is packed with Surgicel and gel foam. The post-operative CT scan showing no residual tumor present. One more case showing an endoscopic modified Denker approach for stage 2C. A 16-year-old presented with nasal obstruction and epistaxis. Diagnosis of juvenile nasopharyngeal fibroma was done. DNA showed a reddish lobulated mass in the right nasal cavity. CT scan showing the mass in the nasal cavity, infratemporal fossa, involving the sphenoid sinus and anterior wall of the cavernous sinus. The tumor in the nasal cavity seen, exposure for modified Denker seen, anterior wall of the maxilla is removed, posterior wall of the maxilla is exposed. Where the posterior wall of the maxilla is removed using an elevator. This gives both the lateral and the lateral control of the tumor is achieved by with careful dissection, and here the internal maxillary artery is identified and lateral vascular control is achieved. The internal maxillary artery is ligated using LIGA clip. And behind which the temporalis muscle can be identified. From where the tumor is carefully dissected out, this is the temporalis muscle. Following which pterygoid lamina pterygoid wedge is identified. Tumor is dissected from its attachments. From the nasopharynx, the tumor is dissected out from its attachments from the sphenoid and the nasopharynx. And from the and the tumor is removed in segmental resection fashion. The tumor is pushed above to remove its sphenoidal attachment from the floor of the sphenoid and the septal attachments. And the tumor is removed in toto. That is the Doppler being used to identify the carotid artery. And the tumor cavity is filled with Surgicel and gel foam. The post-operative CT scan showing no residual tumor seen. The anterior, the in external approaches, the anterior approaches, it's valid for only limited tumor extension into the infratemporal fossa. Because lateral vascular control becomes very difficult in case of anterior approaches, because we have a minimal control over the vital structures of internal carotid artery and cavernous sinus. So it's mainly suitable for any lesions involving the paranasal sinuses, pterygopalatine fossa and midclival lesions. One of the anterior approaches is transoral approach. Superior gingival labial sulcus is exposed and incision is given over it in close to the tuberosity of the maxilla, which provides an access to the lower infratemporal fossa, but it does not actually provide a lateral control for the adequate exposure of the tumor removal. Mainly the view is obstructed from the fatty tissue. It mainly used for access as a biopsy for biopsy, and benign tumor can may be removed. One more approach is transantral approach, where the antral cavity entered is mainly by the sublabial incision from canine to first molar is given. Mucoperiosteal flap is elevated till the infraorbital foramen. It's an approach medial to the infraorbital foramen, and it is mainly to preserve the infraorbital nerve. Window along the anterior lateral wall of the antrum is achieved, or the maxilla is achieved. It gives far better exposure of the posterior wall of the maxillary sinus. The incision is given little above because roots of the canine and premolars are received. Antral mucus of the posterior wall is incised. At its junction with medial lateral and superior wall, mucoperiosteal flap is reflected, which can be placed later. One more anterior approach is transpalatal approach. It is mainly used done to remove the tumor extending to the pterygopalatine fossa and nasopharynx. And the S-shaped incision is vertically given on the soft palate and on the anterior pharyngeal arch towards the side of the lesion. Mucus of the lateral nasopharynx incised vertically. Superior constrictor muscle of the pharynx is split to enter the pterygopalatine fossa and medial part of the infratemporal fossa. The anterolateral approaches are extended maxillotomy, maxillectomy, osteoplastic maxillotomy, maxillary swing approach, mandibular swing approach, and facial translocation approaches. The transmaxillary approach was first described by Langenbeek in 1985. It's an osteoplastic technique for the tumors involving the pterygopalatine fossa. Incision is mainly placed in the buccal sulcus above attached gingiva between the maxillary second premolars. Incision is usually placed half a centimeter above the apices of the tooth to preserve the viability of the tooth. Mucoperiosteal flap is raised. Nasal septum is separated from the anterior nasal spine and maxillary crest. Facial soft tissue is retracted cranially for the exposure of the tumor. The extended maxillotomy approach, transantral approach with extended sublabial incision from midline to maxillary tuberosity is given and is carried down to the depth of the periosteum. Posterior wall of the maxillary sinus widely excised. It gives access to the tumors in the medial part of the infratemporal fossa and pterygomaxillary portion. The medial wall of the maxillary sinus and nasopharynx is also removed. Lateral extension of the tumor exposed by removing the lateral wall of the antrum. It can be combined with transpalatal approach for extensive tumors. This is showing the mandibular swing. It's a variation of a transmaxillary approach. It mainly preserves the function of the soft palate, which is vital for speech and swallowing. Mandibular swing can be approached through lip split incision for mandibulotomy. It's a picture showing a facial translocation, provides excellent exposure with tumors extending from eustachian tube to geniculate ganglia, from superior orbital fissure to the level of the heart palate. Advantages are it gives direct access to the nasopharynx, pterygopalatine fossa, paranasal sinuses, and clivus. The main disadvantages of the anterolateral approaches are very extensive, high risk of osteoradionecrosis, oroantral fistula, and postoperative trismus. Patient may need for there's a need for tracheostomy, and transgressing the contaminated fluid in rates of infections are high. Lateral approaches, mainly the fish infratemporal approaches A, B, C, and D. Infratemporal approaches may be either pre-auricular or post-auricular approaches. It gives an excellent exposure to the infratemporal fossa, pterygopalatine fossa, nasopharynx, sphenoid sinus, posterior lateral orbit, inferolateral to the cavernous sinus. It gives an external excellent vascular control over internal carotid artery. Can be combined with different other external approaches like transtemporal and transnasal approaches. Disadvantage is mainly sacrifice of the mandibular nerve. There is patient might have significant conductive hearing loss, poor control of the other paranasal sinuses and nasal cavity. It is a very lengthy procedure. The take home message from this presentation, that is the anatomy of pericopalatine fossa and infratemporal fossa, is it is a very complex structures, or it is a complex space present with many neurovascular structures crossing each other. So we should be having a thorough knowledge of the anatomy of this area before embarking on any surgical procedure in these areas. And the second point is, any infection or inflammation of this region has to be identified very early, because of the various neurovascular foramina or conduit present, which may lead to the presence of infection, spread of infection intracranially or widespread. So hopefully this class was helpful for you, and if you have any doubts you can ask, as well as so I thank you, sir, for giving this an opportunity here. And this is good. Hopefully I have not taken long time, and this is thank you for everyone for patiently listening, and goodbye, good night.